Let the meltdown begin. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network. I am Gabriel Morency. Let's do this thing, holiday edition style. Ho, ho, freaking ho. As we break it down, this will be our final show of 2013 as we move in on 200 episodes here on the Fight Network. Now, since our last show of the year, we're going to welcome some of our regular contributors back throughout this year, such as Robin Black, such as Mark Bocek. Unfortunately, Joey Odessa got stuck in a chimney somewhere in Costa Rica. Not going to be joining us this evening, but we're going to break down Anderson Silva and Chris Weidman. I don't think it's too early to start taking a sneak peek look ahead to what's going on December the 28th. Misha Tate and Ronda Rousey, Josh Barnett and Travis Brown. It's a kick-ass card. We're coming off the heels of a kick-ass card in Sacramento, which Uriah Faber shows he's far from done. We're going to break all that down. We got some kick-ass holiday theme videos of the week, i.e. violent holiday theme videos of the week. All that and more on tonight's MMA Meltdown. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues. I am Gabriel Morency. We hope you're having a happy holidays and a Merry Christmas around the corner. A lot of great fights coming up in the new year, and we're going to be wrapping up the new year with a great main event and co-main event in Las Vegas and Nevada. We'll break down that card in a couple of moments' time as this is our final show of 2013. And you know what? As much as I've enjoyed doing this show this year, 2013 has sucked. I'm not a superstitious man when it comes to the number 13, but I do believe in the Chinese astrology, and 2013 was the year of the snake. You know, it says it all right there. Says it all. 2014, year of the horse. Much nicer. I'm looking forward to 2014, and I know the man that joins us right now is really looking forward to 2014, because 2013, a lot of bad luck in 2013. Mark Bocek now joins us, UFC lightweight. Mark, it's always a pleasure. How you doing, man?
I'm doing better, and it's always good to be here. Thanks.
Hey, you know, Mark, it's always a pleasure having you on. You've joined us quite a bit throughout the year, and these past years, our final show of the year. You know, you do a great job breaking down the fights, and you're doing that, doing your own videos right now. But we've talked about this, you know, last couple of times you've been on, and I've commended you on your patience and your mental state, you know, despite the setbacks that you've had in 2013. But word on the street is you're going to be good to go this spring, you know, early 2014. We expect to see you back in the octagon.
Yeah, I miss it, Gabe. I mean, I miss it so much. 2013 was really bad, just plagued by injuries constantly. And it really goes to show you can't just overtrain, you know, for 1 year, for, you know, 10 months straight and then expect to be at 100%. It's just not going to work that way. But looking forward to March, April 2014, so things are starting to look better. I never suffered that many injuries before, but I guess overtraining can do it to you.
What's the most frustrating thing? Is it not training for the fight and having, you know, that the light at the end of the tunnel and knowing your opponent? Is it tough to watch fights when you're at home and you're seeing, you know, other fighters, especially in your weight class out there, throwing it down? What's the toughest part of it?
That is the tough part, not being involved, not competing, because I enjoy competing. But before that, I was actually a fan of the sport. I'd never miss an event. It almost got to a point where I didn't watch certain fights and I didn't watch certain events because I couldn't enjoy them thoroughly because I couldn't foresee when I'd be back in there myself. So, I mean, of course, after I retire, I'm still going to compete and watch fights, but I'm still young and able and I know I should be competing and I'm not. So at times, not all the time, it, you know, somewhat more difficult to watch.
You know, I hate to say, oh, you know, you're trying to put a positive spin on stuff. Sometimes, though, when you look back, maybe a couple of years down the road, when you're still going strong, you can look back and, you know, 2013 was kind of rough, but I got my body 100%. You know, I didn't get punched in the head. I didn't eat any knees, no concussions, et cetera. You know, I've heard time and time, you know, sometimes fighters, it's frustrating at the time, but sometimes, you know, the injuries actually help them down the road.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. When I look back at it, I think, you know, yeah, I should have warmed up a little bit better, or I should have stretched more, or I should have... that day when I woke up feeling really sore and I dragged myself to the gym, you know, the body's not stupid. I think I should have listened to it. But like you said, on a positive note, I mean, I didn't really get chin checked. I didn't get, you know, rock bad or anything, and then jump right back into training and, you know, start jeopardizing my own chin like we've seen happen to a few fighters lately.
Now, let me ask you, so... You know, you're itching to get back in there right now. Would it be different if you had George St-Pierre's type of money? Does money change that perception at all? Or, you know, doesn't matter how much money you had in the bank, you'd still want to fight in March?
It doesn't change the fact that I still want to compete. The question would be, how much longer would I compete now? So, I mean, if you put $1 million into my bank account, I'm still fighting regardless in March, April. I don't care. That's not a money issue. Then the question will just be, how much longer will I continue to pursue it afterwards? That's why I gotta admire a guy like George. You know, all those training camps, you know, your bank account's well nested, and you know, he's still getting up in there and busting his butt just like everyone else, you know. And that's not easy, so I always admired that.
And, you know, he's put in a lot of grueling camps over the years. And I kind of look at, like, John Elway, former Denver Bronco quarterback,
right.
Wins two Super Bowls in a row. And they said, you know, he retires after. And they said, come on, John, we can win a third one, man. We can do this. And, you know, they said, listen, you don't have to practice as much. And he said, yeah, if we're just going to play in the Super Bowl, I could do it. He said, I can't go through another camp. I can't go through another entire season. I don't want to go through the entire process again. And it seems like that's what George St-Pierre, people don't really understand. I see people on the internet, oh, he's making $17 million to fight twice a year, you know, suck it up. Yet he's not fighting twice a year. The guy was fighting pretty much every day because, man, they had some pretty damn intense camps for their fights, didn't they?
Well, yeah, what people tend to forget is a fight like the Hendricks fight isn't exactly conducive to the longevity of George's brain or his life. So the fan in me, the fan which admires the hard work and dedication, would love to see him fight again, of course. But on a personal note, I think he made the right decision. And I would love to see him actually never come back, because he got out of this right. He did it the right way. He's got a good head on his shoulders, and he can start that next chapter in his life. And I hope he sticks with that personally.
Now, you know, I remember the original pioneer, so to speak, of Canadian fighters in the UFC with, you know, Carlos Newton, David Loiseau. Canadian fighting has come a long way. Yet suddenly we don't have a champion anymore. Canada like sort of had that rightful spot. Not like with Brazil, but people looked at Canada, oh, you know, GSP and Rory and you know, you and Pearson, all these tough guys here. Yet Canadian mixed martial arts just took a major hit. Nobody else can sell, you know, with all due respect to you and Rory or whoever, you guys aren't selling 55,000 tickets at the Rogers Center. It's amazing.
No, George is the man.
It's amazing
the, man,
the impact. The impact that he's had on Canadian mixed martial arts. And the growth of the UFC is just freaking huge, man. I don't think people realize how big.
Well, yeah, I don't think Dana, you know, was crazy about George leaving. I mean, you
no.
can see some of the interviews. He'll be back. And, you know, they can try and set up some type of super fight, which... with, you know, whoever's going to be the current champion, let's say it's going to be Johnny Hendricks, that's a big money fight, big money rematch right there. But you know, and who's not to say George can't be ready for that? Maybe he comes back and we see the best GSP ever. But like I said, you look at that last fight, nobody can really say George can't take a punch. George isn't exciting because. Frankly, in my opinion, he really put it on the line in that fight.
No, he really did. And the way he sucked it up and actually, you know, came back, which was just,
yeah,
you know.
It was close.
Yeah.
You know, it was close. It's the type of fight where you look at, you know, what criteria do we use to judge fights, you know, the damage, control, this and that, or whatever you like. But in the end, he was the champion. So if you use the adage of you have to dominate and you know, destroy the champion like we've seen in boxing, like we've seen in the past, then, you know, you can clearly make the argument that George won 1, 3, and 5. But if you flip the roles, if Hendricks was the champion and George was the challenger, then I think you would have seen Hendricks retain the belt.
Mark Bocek with us, UFC lightweight. All right, let's take a quick break here on MMA Meltdown. Robin Black will join us in a couple of moments' time. We still have our videos of the week, but let's take a look ahead since we're not going to be on before the year-end card with Anderson Silva and Chris Weidman. We're kicking it with Mark Bocek. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues, as does our conversation with Mark Bocek. It's been quite a memorable year in mixed martial arts. 2013 was it. Not just in the UFC, but we've got a great card, the icing on top of the cake, the cherry on top of the sundae, so to speak, a rematch. And this rematch really sort of snuck up on us, it seems. There's been so many fights and so many cards going on. It's easy to be preoccupied, but boom, it's here. And I don't think it's too early to start taking a look ahead at Anderson Silva, Chris Weidman, too. Mark Bocek with us. And Mark, you know, you were very, very successful. You started doing a video series of some fight breakdowns, and you had to be pretty happy with the amount of hits you got on YouTube.
Yeah, it was pretty good. I got at least a little over 5,000 hits in just a couple of days. I was surprised. I'll definitely be making more in the future for the big events.
Well, we got a big.
I'm not sure if I'll get one in time for this one, but definitely next year I'll be doing more.
This is a pretty big. This one isn't big enough.
This one's huge. This one's huge. It's just the timing aspect.
Yeah. No, I'm just.
We'll see what happens. I'd love to do one for this one.
I'm just busting
we'll
your
do
balls.
A mini one in a second.
Well, no, exactly. You don't need to do it. We're doing one right here and right now.
Exactly.
Anderson Silva and Chris Weidman, second time around. This is interesting to me. It's almost like a Rocky movie in which. Has Weidman become Rocky? You know, he's got money right now. He's, you know, TV appearances right now.
Yep.
He's the champ right now. And I don't know what guys do in their personal life, but from what I understand, he only recently sort of got back into the gym. Like, I think he's enjoyed the championship lifestyle a little bit. I'm not saying that, you know, he hasn't trained and worked hard, because I don't know.
Yeah.
But I've seen this time and time again. Some people act differently when they're the champion. They're not as hungry anymore. And you get that mental aspect. Now we're going to have an Anderson Silva, which I don't know him personally, but from what I hear, he wants his belt back. He actually is focused for this fight. Interesting mental dynamic here, isn't it?
Yeah, interesting aspect. I wasn't aware about that of Weidman, but I mean, I can tell you from experience, from what I've seen, people can let themselves go just from winning a fight, any fight, let alone a championship fight. You can just imagine what can happen with some certain people. Not everybody, though. Not everybody's like that. With Chris, I don't know Chris, so I wasn't. I'm not too in tune with what's happening with him as far as gym time goes. But when I see this matchup, it's interesting, because I think Weidman deep down inside knows that he may not have fought the very best version of Anderson Silva. So with that being said, I think we're going to see the Anderson that's going to take this serious and not trying to put on a last minute show for saving a card like he did with Stephen Bonner. You know, and I think the remotivation factor for Anderson is going to be big since he's been champion so long. And, you know, whenever you're the champion, it's like you're on a constant high, and he's lost that. And I bet he's been doing everything in his power to get that back.
Especially the way that he lost it as well. And not to take anything away from Weidman's win, but it's the way that Anderson Silva lost it, yet it's almost people haven't fully given Weidman credit for it. You know, yeah,
I don't want to take anything away from Weidman.
I know, but at the same time,
he did what he was supposed to do.
Yeah, he did.
So I can't take anything away from the guy, but I do think the outcome will be different in the rematch.
Yeah, and I'm thinking that way as well. It's just Weidman was so hungry and so confident the first time around. I don't know if he can match that. And to match
can't take nothing away from Weidman. He did what he was supposed to do.
Yeah, yeah, and it'll be interesting to see. And I just want to throw out there too, I'm not saying that Weidman's been out there partying every night. I'm not saying that.
Yeah,
I'm just saying that, you know, the guy lost his house, man. So he gets a new house.
Yeah,
he's champion.
We've seen it happen before.
Yeah, it's, you know, I'm not saying he's living a bad lifestyle. All I stated is I heard this camp has been a shorter one, and it's different this time around than it was when he was the contender. And if you're Anderson Silva right now, I mean, you've accomplished so much. His legacy really isn't on the line, but he almost has. It's not an excuse, but people made an excuse for him. Ah, he was screwing around that night. He's going to take this one seriously. So this actually, his legacy, so to speak, actually sort of is at stake this time around, isn't it?
Well, it is, because we all know anytime you take a person who wasn't so financially stable in the past, like, let's say, Weidman, and now you become showered with some money and some fame, it is extremely difficult to stay grounded. Maybe he's the best at staying grounded. I don't know. We'll see in a couple of weeks. Anderson, on the other hand, you know, doesn't have to really worry about money, and he doesn't have to fight anymore. So he's actually missing the only thing that money can't buy, which is the belt. So I think that's going to be the driving force behind his motivation for training.
I like that. Money can't buy everything, right? Almost. Almost.
Right. Almost.
You can buy one of those fake belts. John Jones won't sign it, but, yeah, you can. he won't sign it for you, but, you know, I guess you could buy one of the belts. Ronda Rousey and Misha Tate, it was the Ultimate Fighter show throughout the season. Now we get the rematch. You know, to be honest, I think that Kat Zingano and Ronda Rousey would have been more interesting. I think that Cyborg Santos.
It would have.
You know, Cyborg would be more interesting. A lot of talk about Holly Holm right now. But we get Misha Tate. You know, this is interesting as well from a mental standpoint, in which Ronda, you know, talk about alpha male. Like, Ronda just is that. She's, you know, she's the bully in the room here. And she's tried to intimidate Misha all season long on the TV show. She's already beaten her. But I'm kind of looking at this, if you're Misha Tate here, you're playing with house money, aren't you?
Yeah, I think, you know, Ronda's a great athlete or whatever you want to call it. But, you know, video editing can only do so much. But from my view, it seems she's really come off unsportsmanlike and quite childish, in my opinion, from the show. You know, I think the scene that really, really sticks out to me is after Misha's fighter fights one of Ronda's fighters, and Misha tries to shake their hands in the cage, and Rousey's just flipping her off. You know, whether you dislike someone or not, that's just meant as a sign of respect, and it's really surprising that, you know, someone who's competed in the Olympics can't see or acknowledge that. So she does come off quite unsportsmanlike, and I think the fans have expressed that as well.
I think she's turning into a female Nate Diaz, isn't she?
Yeah, on a personal note, I'd like to see Misha win. I think she's a nicer person and a better person. But realistically speaking, I think Ronda gets an armbar inside of 3 rounds.
Yeah, I think she probably gets an armbar inside of 3 minutes. Let alone the 3 rounds. But, you know, if it's amazing, like, how difficult is it to stay out of that armbar versus Ronda Rousey? Like, you know, if you know that's what she's going to do, it's amazing that it still happens all the time.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's like the wrestler that's been moving people his whole life. You know, if he doesn't get into range with you, none of that stuff matters. But once he kind of locks up your body or your leg, you know, chances are he's, you know, he's just too experienced there. So he's going to get the better of that situation. So, you know, whenever they're in the ground situation and, you know, Ronda locks up an armbar, even if Misha's clasping her hands and is defending, that's just where Ronda's more experienced. You know, Misha would have to keep the fight on the feed and not engage in the, you know, in those judo clinches, which are a little high risk for MMA because it gives your back. But Ronda having the size, strength, and athletic advantage on Misha due to Misha's judo experience, I think, can get away with that. So it's going to be a tough fight for Misha.
Mark Bocek with us. All right, Mark, we got to wrap it up. So about a minute's time here. One of the fights that I'm really looking forward to on the 28th is the War Master, Josh Barnett, taking on Travis Brown. And
yeah.
I look at Barnett, and, you know, he had a couple of losses to Krokop. You know, he loses to Cormier. No shame in losing to Cormier. And, you know, Barnett doesn't really lose, you know, to people unless,
no,
you know,
doesn't.
It's elite people, or it was a hell of a long time ago. I'm liking Josh Barnett in this fight against Travis Brown.
So am I. Barnett's a serious veteran who hasn't gone anywhere. I mean, if anyone's going to get that next, I know they're heavyweights. I'm just saying in reference, if anyone's going to get the 205 belt, I think it might be Daniel Cormier. And Cormier had to really dig deep in that Barnett fight to pull off the victory, especially being his first five-round fight. Warmaster's seen it all. And it's, I don't know, it's just tough to go against Barnett. He's just too experienced. I don't think Brown can really do anything he hasn't seen before.
There it is. Mark Bocek with us, who we look forward to seeing back in the octagon in 2014. Yet, you know what? Your bad luck outside, in and outside of the cage allowed you to join us a little bit more than you would have because you had a little bit more time on your hands this year. So for that,
That's
we're grateful.
That's the good part about being out.
Yeah, you know, for that, we're grateful. You got some other media work in this year as well. So we wish you a Merry Christmas, Mark. A happy holidays to you, everybody in your family as well. We look forward to catching up with you in the near future, man.
Thanks, Gabe. Merry Christmas. I appreciate it. Look forward to being on the show in the new year.
There's Mark Bocek with us. Great breakdowns and insight from a man who makes his living inside of the cage. MMA Meltdown of the Fight Network continues. We're going five rounds with Robin Black. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues. Robin Black will join us in a couple of moments. Great stuff with Mark Bocek. Let's get to our videos of the week. And that's a holiday theme video of the week segment this week. But before we get to the holiday theme videos, we've got a couple of crazy ass knockouts. Now, we're going old school with this one. Yet, with all the talk of Holly Holm coming into the UFC, she does want $100,000 to fight Ronda Rousey. A lot of talk about women's boxing and, of course, women's mixed martial arts. And this is one of the most devastating knockouts you're going to see, male or female.
15 knockouts, but how many people were scared of her and did not really fight her?
Oh, big hand! One punch! That is it! Forget about the count! It is over! Kim Burns!
Fight her!
Sign her up, Dana! Holy crap, man! That's what you call the overhand right. That's some solid-ass stuff right there. So speaking of Dana White signing her up, you know, I think, was the UFC too hard on Paul Daly? Yeah, come on, he pushed Josh Koscheck in the back of the head after a fight. Oh, you can't have that. So what, you can take steroids, you can juice yourself, you know, you can cheat, but you can't, like, push someone in the back of the head once. He made a mistake, because if you don't get Paul Daly back in the UFC soon, he's going to get charged for freaking killing somebody.
Not even after that. At the same time that you're throwing, he's throwing.
But it's like that old cliche. Oh,
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 Great knockout. Great knockout this past weekend from England, actually. Seen right here on the Fight Network. That's right. For those of you in the United States tuning in online watching this show right now, if you're watching the replay on YouTube, like I know many people do, log on to thefightnetwork.com, subscribe, man. You get some great fights, live action, and programming as well. All right, we're not going to be on. Now, it kind of sucks. You know, you guys know me, man. I don't miss shows. You know, we plow forward, yet the show lands on Christmas Day and New Year's Day this year. And hell, even I'm going to be watching football on New Year's Day. So I don't even think I'd watch the show if we were on. So we're not on for a couple of weeks. Pisses me off. I get paid by the show. Happy New Year, as if. As if. Merry Christmas. Here's your Christmas. And here's some pissed off Santa Clauses.
Oh! This is amazing.
Oh, shit. This guy's going.
You have this like camera?
Oh! Oh, that guy got.
These guys aren't very jolly.
Dude, this guy.
Look at giving him to him like in a taxi here. Look at this. There's a big shot coming up here, too. Watch.
Oh my God,
you know, the biggest surprise of that video, that's not in Russia. That's New York City. That's New York City. So, you know, if you want to mouth off, for all you kids out there playing the knockout game, better not try to knock out Santa Claus. You better not laugh. You better not cry. You better not try to knock out Santa Claus, because you'll end up dying. And New York City is full of pissed off Santa Clauses.
This poor Toyota is like,
this is awesome.
So the moral of the story, kids, is if you don't like your present, screw you. You know, because Santa Claus got better things to do, like get drunk and fight on the streets in New York City. Yet, let's wrap it up with a Santa Claus in Europe. And this guy is the coolest Santa I've ever seen. This is a real bad Santa. We missed the second kick. Whoever you're filming, what'd you move for? We missed the soccer kick that I had. Yet, you know, there's our holiday theme. That's as close as we're going to get to some Christmas cheer on this program. But all kidding aside, we wish you a happy holidays and a Merry Christmas and all that other stuff. And Robin Black will join us on the Fight Network. MMA Meltdown continues. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues, and as we alluded to off the top of the program, this is our final show of 2013. So we want to get Robin Black in studio. He's joined us many times in this past year in the new Fight Network studios. Robin, it's always a pleasure.
Good hanging, man. I love it.
It's amazing. This year just flew by. You know, very busy year and a pretty entertaining year of mixed martial arts 2013.
Yeah, overall. But I mean, this December has been crazy. Just great fights, exciting stuff happening. And we still have Weidman and Silva, man. It's been a really, really good end of the year. Sometimes I'm curious about how these numbers do and how many pay-per-views they sell and stuff. I haven't been really paying attention to that, so I don't know how that's going, but I've been really paying attention to these fights and there's good ones, man.
And, you know, starting next year, there's actually going to be more UFC events, which is either a good thing or a bad thing, depending on what side of the fence that you're on. If you think it's already oversaturated, well, there's going to be more. I think there's going to be 43 events next year. Like, they're surpassing NASCAR. The goal is to have an event every week.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what's the upside? Whenever a UFC event is on, certain people, and we're probably part of that group, have your friends over, you put on, you throw a party, it becomes your central event. And that's true of whatever anybody digs. Your NASCAR people, you throw stuff around NASCAR.
But if it becomes too much, Robin, you don't want your buddies coming over every night, right?
It makes it a little less special.
Because look at the NFL. Every Sunday, right? We're meeting in the sports bar. We're getting blasted on Sunday. Yeah. Monday night, you have these set nights. Yeah. But if the UFC has a pay-per-view once a month, it's a big deal.
Yeah.
And I remember years ago, it was a big deal.
Yeah,
remember,
it was like, every 3 months. It was like crazy.
Yeah, bars would have fighters coming, and there'd be like 300 people. Yeah. And you try to do that every week, and suddenly there's three people showing up at the bar. Dana White invites some more friends over. Except you're not having your buddies over every night. There's so many damn events right now.
I know. I will never be disappointed that there's too many fights, but you're right. It does lose some of that specialness. And it's like every Sunday is football. Yeah, if every Saturday night's fighting, I mean, what, I'm never going to do anything else on a Saturday? But the bigger problem, too, might be, if you got 50 shows, you don't have enough top-level guys. We're watching a lot of lower-level fights. And already, this year I got a couple friends on the Ultimate Fighter Canada versus Europe, and that's Ultimate Fighter like 21 or 22. By this point, it's like, wow, I'm on this Ultimate Fighter show. Yeah, you and 200 to 400 other people have been on that show. The whole thing kind of loses its specialness.
It doesn't mean as much anymore. Yeah. And I've said this before. We've talked about this, and we had Phil Baroni on. Phil is a regular on the show. And other veteran fighters, Aaron Simpson, I was talking to about this recently, and no disrespect to any fighters that have fought in the UFC, a couple of times or whatnot, but it's not the same anymore, is it?
Yeah.
It used to mean something, there were 70 guys or you're one of the top 100 guys.
Yeah.
Nowadays, really, 10 guys in every city, right, have fought on a UFC card, right?
Out of
each gym in each city.
Yeah, absolutely true. Just being a guy who fights once or twice in the UFC does not boggle the minds of everybody in the room anymore. There was a time you'd go like, that guy fought in the UFC and be like, no. It'd be like heavy. That was a big deal.
I did a live show in Montreal last week at a bar during the Hunt Silva fight, a week and a half ago or whatnot. And I had David Loiseau there.
Yeah.
And I told Dave, I said, I remember years ago, you were like the legend.
Yeah.
Like, growing up in Montreal, we used to see David at the sports bars, and he never drank. He'd be eating and watching the games and the fights. And it would be exactly that. That guy's crazy. He fights in a cage. That guy's in the UFC, man.
Yeah. And if anybody got out of line, it's like, this guy will elbow you until your brain explodes.
The Crow. It was like, people, and he's a soft-spoken, nicest guy, right?
Great guy.
But, and it's funny, and I asked him, does it bother you that basically everyone's in the UFC now? Yeah. He said, no, it doesn't.
No, it changes, but change isn't a bad thing. We always resist change. Oh, no, there's going to be too many cards. Oh, there's so many guys. But change is good. Yes, the UFC fighter number 411 probably isn't that great. Like, there's guys in your gym that are as good as him, and he's kind of got there. But it doesn't mean the top 200 guys aren't amazing. It doesn't mean the level doesn't come up. It doesn't mean you don't have great fights all the time. But, all with growing pains comes challenges always.
Now, with that being stated, and we're jumping all over the place here, but with that being stated, what about Ben Askren then? Because there's clearly fighters worse than Ben Askren in the UFC. And I was thinking about Ben Askren. I'm thinking, he's kind of a jerk.
Yeah, which is fun.
Yeah, it's so he's polarizing. So people want to see him lose. Is it the fact that he was the Bellator champion and the UFC doesn't want to see him succeed? in their company. Hell, we just saw Zach Mikowski come in and beat up Scott Jorgensen.
True.
From Bellator.
Hector Lombard, though, they were happy to have that guy.
Yeah, and they overpaid for Hector.
Maybe that was part of it.
Now they don't want when Askren, but I'm just thinking, is it personal? Was it really, we don't think Askren's beating anybody? Because come on, you've got guys with less pedigree than freaking Cody Olympian McKenzie that's never lost before.
Cody McKenzie got shorts at the store, and he fell like an hour before.
And he forgot to take the tags off.
Yeah, exactly. He fought in the UFC.
So is Dana or the UFC, are they sort of screwing us, the fans, by not giving us Ben Askren in the UFC then?
Well, the argument is that the boring argument is always thrown at Ben Askren, and that is for certain people who watch fighting a certain way. They find that boring. Personally, I like watching Ben Askren fight. I like seeing him shoot his mouth off. I like seeing him irritate guys. I like his haircut that looks like he's a 3-year-old. I like all that stuff. It's fun. But you can't tell me that he's not in the UFC because he hasn't beat anybody. He's not in the UFC because Bjorn Rebney down-talked him and then kind of challenged Dana White to give him a title shot. And Dana White's literally sitting around going, you know what, I don't play games with Bjorn Rebney. That's why he's not in the UFC. The dude should be in there. He should get 2 wins and fight for the title. Everybody knows it. But, you can't tell me that fighter number 411, who's 6-0, who's fought nobody, is a better qualified guy to fight in the UFC than Ben Askren.
Wasn't Rochelle's brother like 1-3?
Yeah.
And the wrestler.
Yeah.
And, he got on the card a couple of weeks ago. All right, there's a ton of stuff to get to here. Robin does a great job breaking down the fight, some epic professor-like breakdowns that we'll get to in a second, but your quick take on George St-Pierre.
You know what? Good for him, man. The guy went, he did everything. The thing I see about it is, I don't care whether you're, who's that kid with the weird haircut who's like a singer from what's his name? You know,
weird kid with a haircut.
That kid,
that's a
singer. He's like 16. He's like the best.
Bieber?
Yeah, Bieber. That guy. I can't even remember his name.
When you said 16.
Yeah, when you're. I don't care if you're Justin Bieber or Michael Jackson or Tiger Woods or any of these superstars in something, your life is going to fall apart at some point.
Yeah.
It 100% is. George St. Pierre looked at it and said, wait a second. I don't want my life to fall apart. Before it does, let me try not being a superstar for a year or two and see if that helps. George is a very, very smart guy. I know people will be like, why are you comparing him to Justin Bieber? But that's that level of pressure of being a superstar. I mean, everybody's got something to say about you. Everybody hates you on Twitter.
I think Tiger Woods is a better example in the sense that Tiger is dominating the sport. And it's almost that doesn't care if he gets caught.
Yeah,
it was almost that,
wanted to.
And looking at everyone, I'm not perfect, so I've been banging porn stars. Oh, shoot me, I'm a horrible guy. Was there a worse hatchet job on anyone in the history of the world than Tiger Woods?
Yeah, what is it?
Tiger, you should go to rehab. For what? For what?
Yeah, exactly.
For sleeping with women? really? Come on, man. His wife was a gold digger anyway. So no, let's not get into the, he cheated on his wife stuff.
Well, right? I mean, everybody, tell me some hockey player that didn't cheat on his wife. You know what? Are we going to target him for that? I agree with you. But you know what? All of these guys, the wheels fall off it somewhere. The wheels fall off it. And George was feeling that he was going to crack. So he's
stop the car in the track before he crashed.
Exactly.
Right?
And he said, I choose to do this, and for right now, I choose not to do this. The dude is very smart. Go off and get your stuff together, party a little bit, lay on a beach, live your life. You can come back if you still want to be the best fighter in the world. Go do that.
Doing exactly that, as TMZ Sports reports.
Did you see that, though? They're George St. Pierre partying. George was doing the double thumb dance and drinking one beer.
I was very disappointed in the video.
Yeah.
Very, very, very disappointed in the videos. George St. Pierre in Miami Beach. I was thinking bikinis. I was thinking multiple chicks, maybe a hot tub. And
nope.
I was expecting to be jealous.
Yeah,
and like you said, he's dancing with a chick, one thing, in an empty bar.
With one beer.
Yeah, it looked like
man, don't go crazy, George. But that's George, man. He's just going to go have a good time. That's George having a good time.
No, so, he should go have a good time. And we got Robbie Lawler and Hendricks, to move on with, which will be fireworks. But let's not get too ahead of ourselves. So before we get, and this being our last show of the year, before we get to the Silva Weidman rematch, quick recap of this Fox card this past Saturday night, in which it was all about Team Alpha Male going in. They were disappointed Benavidez didn't get it done. Pretty much I'm not going to say shocking, because we're talking about the champion here, but the fashion that he smashed Benavidez. Benavidez never been finished before to get knocked out in that fashion. You know, the second time, very emphatic. You know, hell, the first fight was closer.
Yeah.
You know, you get knocked out in the second fight. Benavidez finds himself in nowhere's land right now. Very frustrating for him. But Demetrius Johnson, it sounds cliche, but he really does just get better and better.
Yeah, and the weird thing, we all are guilty of this in every sport, every fan, whatever you're a fan of. We'll sit there and we'll, like, get this idea in our head. Like, okay, this fight was very close. But Joseph Benavidez has been improving, and we'll watch how much he's improved. His striking's better. He's got a new coach. He's finishing guys. He's hitting the body. He looks so good. And somehow we'll forget that meanwhile Demetrius Johnson is also improving. We'll get so busy fixated. Oh, Joe B is gonna, like, look how much better he is. Meanwhile, this guy's quietly been hiding out with his coach.
With Matt Hume.
Better. Yeah, Matt and Hume. And concentrating on him, getting better
exactly.
and better.
Exactly. Concentrating on him. Not a huge camp. Camp, right? Yeah. Not like, you know, no one talks about Hume. We talk about Jackson, TriStar, Rufus.
Yeah.
Y'all got a million guys coming in and out of the door. Yeah. Seems like they're really just focused on their guy.
Yeah. I think some other people will kind of learn from that. Obviously, it suits a coach and a team and a guy who runs a gym to have a lot of guys, but it suits a fighter to have, you know, be part of one or two. If you can sit there, TJ Grant's got a great coach out in Halifax, Scott McLean, and they sit there in their own lab building these things.
Yeah.
It's not like you spend your hour with your coach and then you go work on it. Together they watch tape and they break things down and they hang out with their families and they're always working together. And Hume is like that with Demetrius Johnson. He got better. While we're all sitting there watching Joe B get better, he got even more better. Better, better.
Now, speaking of better, better, Uriah Faber. Uriah Faber is the type of guy the keyboard warriors like to hate.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, he's done. Oh, Uriah, the company guy. Oh, he gets another title shot. How many title shots is this guy going to get? He's probably going to be getting another one in the near future. And why wouldn't he, the way that he's been smashing people right now? But you break it down like you did with the Carlos Condit, you know, in slow motion.
Yeah.
And, you know, you focus in on his posture and his quote-unquote alpha maleness.
Yeah.
In the cage, and his sheer out aggression and the push slash stiff arm into the fence to me was one of the coolest things I've ever seen in a cage. Like, that's, you know, I watch fights for the wow moment.
Yeah.
That's when I was sitting there and I actually said, holy shit.
Yeah.
It's one of those, like, I was like, holy shit. When he pushed him into the fence, and I told somebody I was watching a fight with, I said, this is like an older brother just beating the crap out of the younger brother.
Yeah.
Everyone loves McDonald.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
He's still young. He's not, you know, Faber's a man.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a man. You know?
Yeah.
Faber's a man that sort of figuring it out right now. And, you know, what a great performance by Uriah Faber.
Yeah, you know what? The guys have been saying forever that it's like 90% mental. There's all these things they use. If everything else is even, if guys are, you know, both really good at stuff, both really prepared, both really well coached, all of that stuff, it's going to be almost all mental. It comes down to, you see them now, you watch it close enough, watch thousands of fights, become consumed with it, and you start to pick up on it. You see statements guys are making to each other in the cage. The statements that they're making, you know, we were talking about it before we went on the air. Shogun looks one way one night, but then against Sonnen he looked another way, and then Tahuna he looked this way. And the state that they're in will make all the difference when everything else is equal. The best man will always win, but if you're almost the same level of best man, where your head is at, the statements you make to the other guy, that all matters. I still swear that Chris Weidman won the belt because of the statements he made to Anderson Silva, not only in the cage, but in the months leading up to it. To get his brain questioning, to get him more desperate, to get him wondering who this guy is and why he's
instead
so confident.
Instead of saying, oh, I'm lucky to have an opportunity, I can't wait, say, I'm going to be the next champion. I'm going to beat this guy.
I'm going to beat this guy. I'm not going to sign a contract to get more money. I'm going to wait till I beat him, and then I know I'm going to have to beat him again. All that has come true. So as he steps into that cage on the 28th, all of that has become true. Now he stands there with Anderson Silva going, shit, he did beat me. Wait, he didn't sign that contract after. Wait, now he says he's going to beat me again. All of those things are little things he sort of introduces to the game he's playing with Silva. Does that mean he's going to win? Silva could knock him out in the first round. We all know it. But it matters. These things are in play.
You've got to believe that Silva's mental mindset's got to be better than it was last time, in which he clowned around.
Yeah.
And speaking of Bieber, he showed up with Bieber. If Bieber walks out with Silva, we know we're done. If Usher or Bieber are seen in Vegas that freaking week, let me know. I don't want any part of it, because I think Silva actually is focused now in the same way that GSP might be in the future. That, you know, all right, I was tired of being champ. No one's going to say I was tired of being champ, but it was mentally wearing on me. I wanted defending.
Yeah,
a little bit of pressure off of me right now.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to go get this.
Yeah.
I wonder about Weidman's mindset, which, you know, he's done a lot of appearances in the last year. A lot of chilling. He only got back in the gym recently.
Yeah.
And it's always different mindset. As you stated, man, it's, you know, it's what Yogi Berra stated. It's
90% mental, 100% of the time.
Yeah, the other 90% mental, the other 50% physical, whatever the hell. But it is all mental. And now that Weidman's the champ, guys come in softer sometimes.
For sure.
You know?
It is a different kind of challenge.
What do you like in this fight?
I still do like Chris Weidman, because now he can introduce that full ground game to it. He can make Silva, you know, doubt himself on the feet or even overcommit on the feet. If Silva starts overcommitting, it's an easy takedown. If Weidman takes him down, all of a sudden that's back in play. If you're Anderson Silva, what has he been preparing for? If you tell yourself it was just a fluke, then you just prepare like normal. And hopefully for Silva, that's what he's been doing. But if you start saying, I'm going to show him, I'm going to make a statement, I got to do X, Y, and Z on the feet, and you get taken down, it's a tricky one. It's a very close fight. I think much closer. We had Weidman. I was calling for a Weidman upset last time. This one is much, much closer, but it's an exciting one, man. It's hard to beat the best fighter in the world. Imagine trying to do it a second time when he's hungry now and he knows.
Two times in a calendar
man,
year.
Yeah, that's tough.
Two times in
but
a calendar
I still,
year.
But if you ask me, you know, that I have to lay down $50 of my hard-earned money, I'm going to lay it on Chris Weidman.
And you know what? Chris Weidman is actually an underdog, just like he was the first time, albeit a smaller underdog than the first time around. All right, great stuff with Robin Black. As I mentioned, if you missed his breakdown of Uriah Faber's dominant performance against McDonald, check it out on the Fight Network. Check it out online on YouTube as well. It's great stuff. It's definitely worth your while. Robin, happy holidays. Merry Christmas.
You too,
always
man.
A pleasure.
You too.
Well, much like this year, this program flew by this evening. Thanks to Robin Black. Thanks to Mark Bocek. Thanks to you at home for tuning in throughout this past year and past years that we've been on. It's amazing. We got back from Vegas, early in 2013, and this year just flew by here at the Fight Network studios. Hopefully 2014 is as much fun breaking it down, and hopefully you stuff your stockings with a ton of winners on December the 28th. Check out SportsRageTV.com over the holidays. I post my daily picks. Happy holidays, Merry Christmas, all that other stuff. Other than that, you're on your own. Later.